Now it's time for the talk from Professor Daniele Caporossi, University of Rome, Foro, Italico, with the topic on exercise in cachexia and the role of the redox homeostasis.
Okay, thank you, Madeleine, for this, for the presentation, and of course I would like to thank the organizer to select this symposium more than 1 year ago, and of course thank you to Malcolm and Charlotte to support this this submission and to contribute to this topic. As you see, my my intention 1 year ago was to try to show some, I would say, nice results about the possible role of a redox homeostasis for the exercise intervention in cachexia. I would say that 1 year ago I was a little bit too much optimistic on the results from this consortium that was granted from the Italian Ministry of Research. Of course, we are having a lot of, nice results, but to be honest, we are still really looking for the clear correlation between redox homeostasis exercise in cachexia. So let's say that I will try to maintain, I will still take my responsibility, but I will try to maintain maybe just a kind of low profile in this sense and showing you some nice results that we obtained. Of course, this is the outline of my presentation. I will give you some molecular features about the phenotype of muscle wasting in cachexia, then try to give some convincing results about the role of systemic redox homeostasis in exercise intervention to counteract muscle wasting, and finally show you some results about the molecular mediators in this exercise intervention to counteract cachexia. Most of the results are coming from animal models. Okay, cachexia, of course, as you may note or you may not, is of course a severe involuntary loss of lean body mass that can be seen in many different chronic disease, and more or less 1% of population suffer by cachexia, but this specific disease is very much linked to some specific type of cancers, and in this case we call about cancer cachexia, and in the more or less 50-60% of cancer patients this disease can be very, very severe, and of course can lead to progressive functional impairment, and as I told you, it's not really associated with all type of cancers, but its progression in some of them is directly associated with the cancer patient morbidity and mortality. As clinical level, cancer cachexia is, cachexia and specifically cancer cachexia is characterized by systemic inflammation and, of course, by a negative protein and an energy balance. So it seems that if we look to the protein homeostasis in the skeletal muscle, but not only in the skeletal muscle, also cardiac muscle, but also other different tissues and organs, there is a completely shift in the protein homeostasis with the reduction of protein synthesis and an increase in protein degradation. What are the causes of a cancer cachexia? Of course, the main actors of this induction is the tumors, and specifically factor released by the tumors. And among these mediators, we can easily recognize, of course, inflammatory cytokines, but also some change in hormonal circulating factor, like, for example, IGF-1 and increase in myostatin. And these kind of factors released by the tumors can, of course, activate some specific signaling pathway in different, in many different tissues, causing this very high increase of protein breakdown. As I told you, cachexia actually can be seen in many different tissues, but for the therapeutic purpose, actually, the cancer-induced skeletal muscle mass loss has received, I would say, the critical importance. And this is because, of course, we know from the aging study that there is a very, very high importance of muscle for the health maintenance during aging. And of course, there is a very clear established role for maintaining health during obesity, like, for example, was the comment of one of the previous discussants, and of course, in patients with many chronic diseases. But I can say that if you look to all the studies related to the cancer cachexia and on the molecular pathways, actually most of the studies are just referring to the skeletal muscle mass loss as the primary outcome. And in this case, there is some bias in the data collected so far, because of course, looking just to the skeletal muscle mass as the primary outcome, we are of course limiting the number of specific pathways that can be revealed related to this specific phenotype, because of course there is not really much studies related to the skeletal muscle quality that of course also incorporated the muscle metabolic capacity and also on the recognition of the skeletal muscle as endocrine organ. So trying to go through the molecular pathways that are deregulated in the muscle wasting determined by cachexia. Of course, one of the main pathways is the ubiquitin proteasome system, which is specifically activated under the control of the atrogen transcription. Another pathway which is clearly activated in cachexia is autophagy, which with a very high degree of removal of both damaged organelles and, of course, damaged proteins. Oxidative stress, which of course is a process which of course can also influence the activation of the UPS system and the autophagy, is usually impaired. I mean, it's increased because there is an impairment of the redox homeostasis. And of course, at systemic level, there is the production of inflammatory cytokines that, for instance, can activate the UPS and the autophagy by the activation of specific transcription factor, and then the specific decrease of some anabolic hormones and growth factor. One of the emerging pathways that are now, receiving considerable interest is actually the possibility that one of the main process which is regulated actually depends from the mitochondrial that of course we know very well are involved in regulating both muscle mass and metabolic quality of muscle. And in a very nice review which has been just published, the authors demonstrate very clearly that in the collecting all the data, the cachectic environment, of course, including systemic inflammation, decrease in circulating hormones and change at skeletal muscle level, of course, the mitochondrial quality is reduced in respect, of course, the capacity of biogenesis. In dynamics, that means the capacity of fusion or fission. In the rate of mitophagy, that means a specific autophagy of dysfunctional mitochondria, and of course in the control of apoptosis and in the mitochondrial function. I will skip these two, just to show you that other nice data are actually focusing on the mitochondria as one of the main actors in the initiation of the cachectic process. For example, in some specific animal models, but also with some verification from human studies, these authors very nicely demonstrated that the mobilization and activation of fat substrate utilization from white adipose tissue and the so-called browning of the white adipose tissue usually precede the appearance of skeletal muscle loss in many different models, animal models of cachexia. And this white adipose tissue browning is usually depending from a very high increase of mitochondrial activity with a very high expression, overexpression of the uncoupling protein 1, and of course a deficit in energy production with respect to thermogenesis. And this kind of results has been also confirmed very recently in a skeletal muscle in which actually cachectic cancer cells, through the release of a specific circulating factor, can actually increase the fatty acid oxidation in human myotubes, and so inducing oxidative stress, deactivation of P38, and so also the impairment of muscle growth. And that oxidative stress is actually related to the cachexia phenotype, is, I would say, quite established in the literatures. As for example, this is one of the papers that can be found, in which, for example, the vastus lateralis of cachectic patients with lung cancer or cachexia due to respiratory deficiency actually presents not only a systemic inflammation but also an increased level of muscle protein oxidation and of course ubiquitination, which and these two processes are positively correlated, and there is a specific activation of a redox sensitive signaling pathway, like for example the activation of the transcription factor NFKB and FOXO. And also there is an increased level of autophagy markers, which are in a way related to the oxidative stress. And the fact that oxidative stress is systemic oxidative stress is related to the cachectic phenotypes led, for example, to the use of antioxidant as coadjuvant therapy in cancer cachexia. But what about exercise? As you know, exercise is considered from many point of view a kind of a natural antioxidant, because we know that muscle contraction will determine specific adaptation to skeletal muscle. And among these adaptations, of course, the increase of all the different protein expression related to the antioxidant system is a kind of priority. But in addition to the fact that exercise and specific kind of exercise like endurance or strength training should of course counteract cachexia because of the stimulus on muscle hypertrophy, we know that exercise is also able to act specifically in most of the molecular, let's say, actors that are dysregulated during cachexia, okay? So, of course, exercise, as I would say, a very priority as the possibility not only to lower the oxidative stress at muscle tissue, but also should be able to act directly on the signaling pathways which in cachexia actually activate the ubiquitin proton system linked to the increase of protein degradation. And this will be very short because Malcolm already talked about the role of reactive oxygen species production. Of course, we know that after single boot of exercise, especially if it's not, we are talking about exhaustive exercise, the sudden and high increase in the active oxygen species from mitochondria or from other sources in the muscle can be harmful. But actually, accustomed exercise can actually increase the production of all different proteins related to the decrease of oxidative stress. That exercise, even in aging, can ameliorate the systemic oxidative stress. It's very well documented, and I will show you some results from our groups that actually has been done not in cachectic patients, but in elderly people. In these specific protocols, elderly subjects were included in 12 weeks of power training, low intensity, low frequency, and we, of course, check for the skeletal muscle strength and power and function. And of course, as expected, this specific kind of strength training intervention increase nicely both strength and power. But what we looked for was to the systemic, so at blood level in the serum and also in the circulating blood cells, about the redox homeostasis. And we were able to demonstrate actually that this kind of exercise, in addition to the specific benefit to skeletal muscle, is also able to decrease oxidative stress at systemic level, like for example with the decrease of the myeloperoxidase, which is a specific enzyme related to the production of atherosclerosis plaque. There is also a specific amelioration after the training in the capacity to deal with the stress proteins. That means after the training, all the subjects show the lower level actually of artichoke protein, meaning that the subject adapted to a new kind of regime, and this and was also a specific amelioration in some antioxidant system, like for example in the thioredoxin system. In addition, if these subjects are submitted to an acute exhaustive bout of exercise, which we know very well is able to induce oxidative stress at systemic level, after training, we were able to demonstrate that trained elderly subjects in respect to untrained elderly subjects were very much able to cope with the induction of oxidative stress in terms of a production of malonyldehyde, so that means lipid peroxidation, protein carbonylation. This is the response of trained subject. This is the response of untrained subject, but also in terms of, for example, reduction in muscle damage like creatine kinases. So exercise promises, of course, to support the reduction of systemic oxidative stress. But when we go to subject with cancer cachexia, I would say that up to now, although there are quite good number of studies, there is no general consensus for the capacity of exercise actually to counteract specifically cancer cachexia. Of course, it's quite complicated actually to draw a very specific overview because, for example, in most of the study, it's not clear the degree of cachexia. Of course, cachexia can be defined as a pre-cachexia state, and usually this is the only period in which subject can say, be involved in a specific exercise intervention. There are not specific information about the general level of muscle atrophy. So, despite there is no still consensus about the possible positive effect of exercise, at least in human models, of course, we have, I would say, very nice results from animal studies. And I will show you just some of the results from our consortium, just dedicated to the capacity of exercise to counteract cachexia. We are in a, here we are using actually a very, very typical mouse model of cancer cachexia. Of course, these are tumor-bearing colon cancer, and this kind of animals, usually they develop muscle cachexia very, very rapidly, and the results that I show, of course, that I'm going to show you are just some selected results from this paper. And this data usually came from comparing the activation of specific molecular pathways specifically related to cachexia just before the implantation of the tumors and 18, 19 days after. So this is the comparison of the animals, and as you can see here, we have been using two different kind of groups. That means control mice. C26 means tumor-bearing mouse that were just kept in an environment-rich cage, but with not will in the cage. So we are talking about voluntary running. So we have a control group without a tumor, tumor-bearing mice, sedentary, let's say, and with voluntary running. And these are groups that have been submitted to a specific drug therapy, but I would say I will escape this kind of results. So, looking to the difference in the initial body weight and in the final body weight, of course, we can see that the tumors can induce loss of lean body mass, and this is, of course, counteracted by wheel running. Going to the specific molecular, I would say, muscle phenotypes and molecular phenotypes, here you can see that the weight, for example, of not just of the all the animals, but this specific muscle, like for example tibialis anterioris, can be maintained in tumor-bearing mice submitted, I mean, that are allowed to have a voluntary running, and also the median of a cross-sectional areas is maintained with wheel running. And wheel running also is very effective in delaying the, would say, fatal effect of cachexia. And there is a very clear correlation between the running distance and the survival of the tumor-bearing mouse. Looking to the molecular mechanism, this group just focus on the autophagic system, and of course we look to the atrogenes, and this is the level, of course, in the skeletal muscle of the control. This is the level of the tumor-bearing mice, and this is the level of the tumor-bearing mice just allowed to have voluntary wheel running. And this is the relative expression of the atrogen and the MARF. And also look into the specific markers of the autophagic process, like, for example, the LC3B and the P62. It's very clear that the wheel running is able to maintain the, would say, healthy level for both the DLC3B, the P62, and also the ratio. So the take-home message of this presentation is, of course, that muscle wasting in cachexia seems to be primarily determined by signaling pathways, which lead to the activation of the ubiquitin proton system and, of course, a deregulation of the autophagy. And the increase in activity and deregulation of mitochondrial activity actually could be one of the crucial process related to the loss of mass in both skeletal muscle and, of course, also in adipose tissue, which in turn can lead to an increased production of reactive oxygen species and systemic oxidative stress, which, of course, can play a critical role. Of course, there is a very, very good correlation between the systemic and muscle-specific oxidative stress, which one of the main processes involved in cancer cachexia. We know that exercise training, of course, is able to ameliorate the redox homeostasis at systemic level, but so far we do not have any specific evidence in humans that the regulation of a redox homeostasis is really or could really play a specific role in the exercise intervention for cachectic patients. But we have a very nice results in animal models showing that physical activity can actually specifically counteract the cachexia-induced muscle wasting, especially at least in the model that we have been using, restoring the autophagic process. And having said that, it would be too complicated just list the names of all the people working under this consortium. So just let me thank the Ministry of the Italian Ministry of University Research that granted this project and all the five different university research centers collaborating, and of course, also my university, which is coordinating this project. Thank you very much.